Yo, what's going on, guys? It's CryptocTMG and I'm back with a brand new video. And this time it's going to be another LFM race that I did around Zandvoort. But today I'm going to be talking you through sort of race management and how to sort of manage your races after patch 1.8, because I feel like it's a lot different, a lot more drastic in terms of your tire wear and looking after the car. And yeah, Zandvoort being quite a tough track to look after tires and stuff like that. So I thought it would be a good base to show you guys what I'm doing to sort of cope with the strains of having a race. And this is only a 25 minute race, so of course for the hour long races, 90 minute races, it's going to be this on a much bigger scale, but the same sort of idea remains in terms of how you go about your racing. For me, I feel like patch 1.8 is quite difficult in terms of not being able to just thrash the car and do whatever you want. But this is the qualifying lap that I did. I've done about four races around Zandvoort at the moment, and each time I'll be getting quicker and quicker. And had a few quick guys in here. We had Gregor Schill was in here as well. I think he actually did set the fastest time, but I believe he likes to start the races from the back, so he gets himself disqualified in the pit lane after doing quali. He's about 2.5-3 tenths quicker than us, so I thought our pace wasn't too bad, man. We're definitely getting there again with the Bentley, because I wasn't feeling how the Bentley felt after the patch. But so far, decent enough lap. I actually got blocked twice before on my hot lap, so it pretty much was down to this lap to sort of get a good time. And you can see we're like down in fifth, and yeah, really had to take evasive action on the lap just before this. So yeah, coming around the final corner now, about to do a 34.8, which is not too bad, not too far away from the kind of times we were doing before the patch. So yeah, pretty happy with that. That ended up being second place on the grid, but as I said, Schill got himself disqualified purposely, so it gave us pole position for the race. So for the race, we actually made a few changes to the setup. I was running quite an oversteery setup for quali. That was really to get the nose in for the corners. But what I did is I reduced the camber by about 3 clicks on the front tires and about 2 clicks on the rear tires. And I also went up 1 on the rear downforce. So making sure that around a circuit like this, where through the middle sector, where you know you do a little bit of trail braking into the corners, and the back end does tend to step out, especially on acceleration around the middle sector. So trying to make sure I had more downforce, just to make sure I'm keeping the back tires in, not putting too much stress through them, because again, this is a track where once you start sliding, once you start heating up your tires, it's pretty tricky to you know, reduce the temperatures. And because one corner sort of follows another through the middle sector, you overheat them through one, then you end up overheating them more through the next one. So that was my thinking going into this race, is just make sure that the car feels a little bit steady through that section. Even if I do lose a little bit of turning, I'd rather have you know, tire pressures and tire temps that are regular instead of being too hot, because now I feel like it's a much bigger problem than it used to be. But starting the race, I actually got a bit of a bad start. You can see the guy in second actually gets quite a good start. He only qualified about 5 thousandths behind us, so our pace was pretty similar going into turn one. He squeezes us, trying to make sure he gets to move around the outside, but I sort of stayed calm, and it tends to be quite clean in LFM, man. Like, they will give you space. I managed to just keep my nose ahead, and now I was straight into, you know, tire management mode. And from the races I've done, the experience that I've built up so far on patch 1.8, I know if you push these tires too hard, too early, you will pay for it. Even in a 25 minute race, before the end of the race, sort of, you know, 15 minutes in, you will definitely feel, you know, the loss of grip. And you can see this guy, he's absolutely sending it flying. I saw him coming, I decided to let him go, let him have it. I tried to cut back on the inside, and at this moment in time, my tires weren't ready either. And you know, he managed to get the best of us through this part of the race, and I thought, no problem, I will still go into the same race management mode. The only problem is that sometimes when you got somebody behind you also, you know, trying to get the position, it can be sort of tricky to manage your race and not sort of overshoot corners and stuff like that. So pretty tricky at the moment, the position I'm in. I've got a Ferrari behind me who is, he's quite quick as well. He was only I think 2 or 3 tenths off in quali, so I knew he was quite a fast guy too, so it was going to be hard to manage your tires and still defend at the same time. But at the end of the day, it's beneficial so far, from what I've learned, it's very beneficial to bring your tires in slowly. And you'll see in a minute, this guy up ahead, he just starts absolutely flying at the start of the race. He was off. All right, guy behind me also putting lots of pressure on. I'm just trying to make sure I'm not sliding the car, not overheating any tires, just trying to keep it as cool as possible. But you can see, you know, in the braking zones how much the guy behind me starts catching up. And I was looking at the guy in front of me, I was just watching his lines to see how hard he was pushing into the corners, how hard he was running his car, because I just thought, I know if I just relax, even if he gets away, I can't think about what sort of pace he's doing. I'm not going to overdrive my car to try and keep up if he's just got a quicker pace. So I'm going to do what I can do now. I'm going to try and keep it as calm as possible. Even then, I was still missing the apexes because, you know, the tires weren't ready. So it's very tricky at the moment, man. But I like the actual aspect of literally managing your tires, managing your race. I do find it quite fun, and it's something a little bit different as well. Even in a 25 minute race like this, there is other aspects that are involved instead of just go as fast as you can, you know, which is racing at the end of the day. Well, which is racing these days. You do have to think a lot about outside of the box. You have to think more about the status of your car, how your car feels, the balance, your whole stint, you know, when to push, when not to push. So many things go into being quick these days. But yeah, you can see the guy ahead, he's absolutely flying, 1.7 seconds ahead, and it's the end of lap two. So yeah, he's absolutely gone. But for me, just pace myself. As I said, I see the guy behind me, he's throwing it in the braking zones as well, and I wasn't braking mad late, but I wasn't exactly braking early, so I knew this guy was pretty much standing on the brakes. You can see he's all over us, everywhere, and I think a lot of it is my driver style. As you see him get tagged in the background, so he actually gets spun around, so it gives us that little bit of freedom where we don't have to keep looking in our mirrors, and I'm able to just concentrate on the job that I need to do. And I previously had a race around here where I was racing somebody, and he was in quali, he was quicker than me. In the start of the race, he was quicker than me, but he pushed so hard, and then when it came to sort of the last 8 minutes of the race, I literally caught him and I was just all over him because he'd killed his tires, man. And sadly, that's what it is. Well, not sadly, I actually like it. That's what it is on ACC at the moment. If you're doing a race, even if you do a race and after you come out of the pit stop, bring your tires in slowly, because you can, you know, do a pit stop, come out, ring it for two or three laps, and the drop off is absolutely massive. And I've seen it a few times now, especially since this patch. So you'll see with my lap times at the moment, I'm doing 36.5 was my fastest lap time. Now I'm about half a second up on that, but you'll see the guy ahead, he's well quicker than what I'm doing at the moment. He's about half a second faster than what I'm able to do. But, you know, but at the end of the day, this is what I'm allowing to happen. I'm allowing him to open up the gap because I know that I'm going to be able to do the pace that I can do for a longer period of time. But again, moving forward into the race, you can still see he's got about a 2.2 second gap. Again, I'm going a little bit quicker again on this lap, finding a bit more pace, but still trying not to slide the car, not trying to do anything drastic. The only pity was my tire pressures were off. Especially around Zandvoort, it's pretty tricky because of the right-hand curb, which you'll see coming up in a second. If you hit that curb one too many times, it literally just takes the pressure out of your tires. And yeah, it's a Zandvoort issue that you have every time. This is the corner, if you took a bit too much of that curb, it would literally just completely get rid of your right hand tire pressures, man. And you could already see they're down in the first place, so that was the issue that I was dealing with. So through corners like this, I'm probably not going to get the amount of grip that I want. It's not ideal, but you know, in the Bentley, I've always felt the Bentley is one of the better cars at driving through problems, man. Most other cars, like the Audi, when I try the Audi, if your pressures are wrong, you can't keep anywhere near the pace that you're supposed to have, man. So coming up to the penultimate corner again, you can see he's got about a 2.4 second gap, so he's opened out the gap again, but we are a little bit closer to the lap time that he did before. And I think we just touched the gravel there, so we're gonna lose some of that time we gained, but still, again, not thrashing the car, not feeling the need to. He does a 35.4, I do a 35.7, so he's about 3 tenths quicker again. But we're still not worried. I know that I have pace in the bank, and we just, you know, keep on moving forward. Again, as we'll come across the line. You can see again we'll improve. We do it 35.6, and for the first time it was actually a tenth quicker than him. So it took us almost 10 minutes for us to do a faster lap than what he was able to achieve. So we're holding a gap around 2.5 seconds. The guys behind us about 2.3 seconds. So let's see how the gaps work themselves out as the race goes along. You can see our pace between the guy ahead and the guy behind is pretty similar. We're lapping around the same lap times, and that's the thing with race management. You're not sort of you're not racing the guy's ultimate lap times, because I know from quali our ultimate lap times are pretty similar. You're racing them in terms of their management and their ability to manage the car. And when you're doing that, it's a different skill set. Being able to drive at a certain pace and not kill the tires, and being able to have a different thought process and think about other things rather than just how fast can I go on this lap. And you can see again I'm improving 2.5 tenths up, opening up the gap to the car behind. And now we start taking temps here and there out of this guy in front. He's still lapping pretty consistently though, still lapping pretty quick, but I could tell through certain sectors where he was flying before, I'm starting to hold him and I'm starting to gain on him now. So I knew probably that when it comes towards the end of the race, he may struggle. Early on in the race, I saw, especially through the tight hairpin, he was sort of almost sideways into that. So I knew he was kind of throwing his car into that. So he does another 35.7. I do a 35.5. So again, I have a couple attempts. Guys behind doing 35.7. So you can see the pace between everyone is pretty similar, not too different. But again, 15 minutes to go. And you wouldn't think in a 25-minute race that it was, you know, so much to do with management, but it is. Now, you know, not a 25-minute race, like it is after 10 minutes or so, you can feel the tires, especially if you abuse the tires, man. And it's kind of interesting that they've chose to do this. It sort of feels like, you know, it sort of feels like a F1. When you watch a lot of the F1 races, you know, if they need to manage a one-stop strategy, a lot of the time they're not pushing. They might do fastest laps here and fastest laps there, but a lot of the time they're driving within themselves. And it's kind of a technique I think that, you know, a lot of people may want to try on ACC, man, especially for your stint length. You know, you can, I could have probably gone out and maybe rang out a lap like a 35.0, like if I just went all out on one lap. But then how much is that going to cost me over the whole stint? And it's kind of like, you know, you kind of have to like swallow your pride sometimes. Like watching this guy drive away early on in the race, I was thinking, there's no way this guy was like, he was my speed in quali, there's no way he's just gonna destroy me in the race. And previously that would have been the mentality, especially on the last patch where didn't really used to manage tires that much, just used to, once you got comfortable, just used to start throwing it around. But definitely on this patch you need tire management, you need to manage your tires. It's 110% for certain. And I like what low fuel motorsport do, especially in the 45-minute races where they make your pit stops 25 seconds by default. So you can either, you know, you can choose to fill up your car with half the fuel, which is what most people do, but then if you want to change your tires, it's going to cost you 30 seconds, which is an extra 5-second pit stop. So you have that sort of that jeopardy of should I change my tires and add 5 seconds to my pit stop, which is going to drop me positions behind people, but then I'm going to have the fresh tires. And I can tell you now, fresher tires are massive when you're racing against guys who are not managing their tires properly, because in the first stint they'll match you all the way, they might even pull away from you, but in the second stint the guys that don't change their tires, they fall off massively because they just push too hard in the first stint. And sometimes they're lapping like 1.2, 1.3 seconds off their fastest laps. And then you come with your fresh tires and you're lapping at, you know, 1.5 seconds a lap quicker. It's not hard to make up a 5-second gap, man. So yeah, definitely check out the low fuel motorsport, the 45-minute races. This was a 25-minute race, like I said before. I think it's my fourth one of the week that I've done. But again, want to sort of just bring you guys in what I'm doing. This guy's still lapping pretty good, man. 35.6. I'm doing a 35.7. I believe he was a tenth quicker on the last lap as well, so he's still lapping there or thereabouts. But then you see the guys behind starting to drop into the 36s now, starting to lose time. And It's only been a few laps and you can see they've lost a second pretty much over two laps. That's like half a second each lap. And you can see I've still got pace. I'm still not really worried. I'm just banging in the 35 fives at the moment. And I was thinking, wow, this guy's done a pretty good job managing these tires because he's still, you know, lapping at the same pace. But from my previous experience, I realized that after about 8 minutes or so, when there's like 8 minutes of the race to go, that's when you started to see the biggest drop off, man. And through the sector already, I've gained quite a lot, and I'm going faster again. I think his fastest lap he did, like within the first couple of laps, he was at like a 35.3. So I know he went out pretty hard at the start of the race. But see, I'm able to still carry the pace through because, you know, just that little bit of management. I do wish so much that I had my PSIs right, man. I should have probably overinflated them on the right hand side because I know what Zandvoort is like. And again, just other little things as well. At this stage, I was getting a little bit of understeer into the slow corner. So I think I moved the brake bias back one click. And that's another thing, man. You got to learn to manage your car on the fly. If something doesn't feel right, try and change something, man. Don't just leave it and just race through it, man. Try and change something to make your situation better. So he does a 35.5 and I do a 35.4. I was thinking, wow, this guy really, you know, he's kind of got it, man. He seems as if, you know, he's managing tires, his pace isn't really dropping off, he's, you know, managing the pace like I am. So I thought, okay, if I can get to sort of, you know, like 2 seconds, then for the last few laps I'm just gonna start going all out. And even if at least if I ruin the tires, it's going to take about 2 or 3 laps and I might just have another lap or two to do at the end with tires that don't feel that great. So at least for the majority of the race, you know, my tires will be in a good state. But again, I closed sort of 2 tenths over the last couple of laps, which is not a lot, but again, I still just wanted to give him something to think about. As we hit that curb, you can see the pressure loss that we get again, which is just annoying. It's so bad around this track, always has been a tough track to keep your PSIs intact, especially hitting that curb. But I also feel like hitting that curb is just part of getting a quicker lap time, man. As I said, I really just wanted to give him something to think about. And you know, you see this a lot of the time with like Lewis Hamilton's done it many a times in the past, where he will keep his tires in and for a while he won't close on you, and it gives the person ahead the full sense of security that you've got no more to give. You can't do anything. And once they've, you know, they've pushed their tires to the limit, once they've done that, and then all of a sudden you start catching them, they physically can't defend with anything because they've got nothing left. And you kind of want to play sort of mind tricks on people to make them think that you've gone through that stage before they have, if you know what I mean. And again, now you can see we're starting to take time out of him, down to 2 seconds. And now I'm starting to think, yeah, he's definitely struggling. He's definitely going to be looking in his mirror thinking, hold on a second, where the hell has this guy got this pace from? He was actually on for quite a good lap on this lap, but I lost it through some sections. I got a little bit sideways, started to get a bit excited. Once I started seeing that, yeah, I think he's done, lads. You can see the guys behind completely and utterly being dropped now. Completely and utterly being dropped. They're definitely struggling with tires. You can see they've completely fallen off the radar. But again, I hit that curb, even though I shouldn't, because I know what happens. You can see now 8 minutes left in the race and the pace difference is starting to show now, starting to close up pretty easily. And I lost all this time, and I was on for like a 35.1 and I just lost a little bit of time. But again, I'm also going to be struggling from tire wear. As much as I am managing, I'm definitely going to be struggling myself from tire wear. But still closing the gap in, we've gone from like 2.3 to like 1.7 in the space of a lap. And that's when I knew, I didn't see any visible mistakes. So that's just literally just grip. That's just him just losing grip and purchase through corners, man. but yeah, it was a pretty enjoyable race. And there is sort of an element that you can enjoy about, you know, managing your race. We still come across the line, do a 35.3. He does a 35.7, which still isn't even terrible. But now he knows I still got pace. So I know his thought process is going to be, I either need to pick up the pace, I need to try something. And that's when you start overdriving, man. If the grip's gone, there's just not a lot you can do about getting that time back, man. You see the guy behind again lost like another second almost. So he's like 5.5 seconds behind. It was only a few laps ago, he was like 2.5 seconds. And you can see what happens when, you know, that extra grip is just gone. And now also this sort of thing gives you confidence because you sort of know you have the race in your hands. You know you've got the pace to win. And you know that the person in front is going to be looking in the mirrors. They're going to be clock watching. And, you know, most people, if they clock watch, they tend to start making a few mistakes, tend to start, you know, trying to push too hard and stuff like that. So, you know, but for me personally, I was getting excited. I knew I was closing the gap. Even though this is such a tough track to pass on, you can sort of force people into mistakes, man. But you can see there, I'm going to that corner, and for the last sort of 4 or 5 laps, it just hasn't been, the nose has not been getting into that corner at all well, man. At all. And I see he runs wide at the penultimate corner, which is going to mess up his run onto the back straight. And it's like, wow. Earlier on in this race, he was absolutely flying. He was doing 35 frees right from the beginning. You see he drops into the 36s. That wasn't a great lap for me either. But you can see he's definitely dropping time now. And it's just down to me to try and keep consistent, try and keep applying the pressure, and see what I could do, see what I could, if I could force him into any mistakes. But this was the section I felt through the first and the middle where I was gaining a lot. He's on the curb on the exit, back end stepping out, all sorts, trying to just, you know, keep his lead. Just 5 minutes to go. So, you know, you always get apprehensive. It's like a football match when you're winning 2-1, but it comes down to the last 5 minutes of the game, and all of a sudden everything seems a little bit more nervy. And I could almost sense the nerves, man, closing in on the brakes. And it was just, yeah, I was so glad with the job that I had done, you know, early on in the race, not trying to follow him, not trying to just do all I could to keep up, because we'd probably be in the same boat if I sort of tried to keep up with what he was doing at the start. We probably would have both been struggling. Then it would have been, you know, who's the best at driving a struggling, you know, gripless Bentley, and it probably wouldn't have been me. But catching up again, down to 8 tenths, and really now we're starting to get into the dirty air. So I have to kind of think, look where he's fast, look where he struggles, that he can't barely get towards the apex of the last corner. So down to 6 tenths, and he knows it's coming, man. 4 minutes to go. The guy's behind dropped over 6 seconds behind. He's at a 36.5, so he's lost almost a second's worth of pace. And this is where it gets interesting, man. I believe I got one of these corners, and I think I made a small mistake. I think I caught one in the grass. I think it's on the next lap, but I can see him struggling, man. And yeah, this is a technique that, you know, I think going forward that I'm gonna have to try, especially in the long races. Maybe a little bit more difficult doing it in hour-long races, and especially when in these big grids where you've got a lot of pressure and everyone's sort of similar pace, it's going to be a lot harder to look after your tires. But I think it's something that's going to be coming very, very useful in races, man. Just, you know, seeing how fast you can go without really stressing the tires. So you see, we go a bit too deep into that corner. Maybe should have went straight down to first earlier, but I can see now his grip in the corners for him is just absolutely nowhere. And this is not like a great lap or anything. We're only on for a 35.6, but we're keeping up with him so easily now, it's just insane. And I felt like I didn't want to brake too late, because I felt like he had to start braking early, and you know, his car's a little bit all over the place. And as I said, look at the lap time, it's about to be a 35.9, and look how much he's struggling now. We tried to go towards the inside, but we knew he was going to squeeze us out. So again, we had to back out of it a little bit. And this was the penultimate lap, I believe. So I was right on him. And again, he's already started to defend because he knows his car's pretty much out of there. But I think this is the lap we make the mistake on. Definitely quicker through turn one. By this time, yeah, as I said, his tires are absolutely done for. And we just, I don't even know what happened there. We just get completely and utterly sideways from absolutely nowhere, you know. I pushed it too hard behind him, and in the aero wake we just lost a bit. But you can see we've lost about 2.3 seconds. So now you're gonna see, you know, the pace advantage that I would have had had I'd kept the lead and stuff like that, and you know, was able to manage the tires of someone behind me. Because let's look, after we get to the end of this lap, look at the lap I'm able to do, even after 25 minutes of really just managing most of the time. And you'll see that we had far, far, far more pace to give just by, you know, being a little bit mindful of our race, man. So he's about 2.3 seconds ahead. You can see we hit the curb before as well, and we lost pressure in the rear right-hand tires too. So yeah, the tires on the right-hand side are well, what, like one PSI too low, or even more than that on the rear right. So yeah, 2.3 seconds, one lap to go. Let's see how much I can close the gap. And the car still felt pretty good, even though I you know, had a bit of a nasty slide. The tires were able to cool down because, of course, I had my brake ducts quite open as well. I think I had them on 5.3. So there he does a 36.1. And now it's time for us to see what we can do on the last lap. And this lap, I just pushed. You know, the car doesn't feel as good. It didn't feel as nice to drive because, again, tire wear and stuff like that. But I still had enough grip, and I just started sending it. I thought, I'm going to try and apply as much pressure, try and get as close as I can. I knew the win was kind of gone unless he made a mistake, because of the mistake that we made. But I just thought, you know, I just wanted to give him something to think about. If I could force him into a mistake any way I could. And you can see we definitely got pace, man. Look how much time we've gained. 6 tenths already. And we're just in the first sector. 6 tenths. And it just keeps on going down and going down. We're able to get the nose into this corner. So I think a bit of aero disturbance being right behind him. I couldn't seem to get the nose into that corner when I got close enough to him. But car felt decent. Still felt decent. Just so sad on my right hand tire. Look at that 25.4 on the front right. That is like over 2 PSIs too low, you know. So I do feel like I could have had even more pace, but we're still closing the gap. We've closed a second in one lap. And a couple more laps we would have been on him, but again, it's a pretty tricky track to overtake. You can see how much we've made up. We've made up about 1.3 seconds on him in one lap, and that was pretty much it, man. And yeah, this is just more of a video to show you guys what I feel like you should be doing now. You can see examples of it. You know, I spoke to Dowking. He's saying the same thing around the pit stops, not pushing too hard when you come out the pits, and make sure you keep something back so your tires do last the duration of the stint. Hope you guys did enjoy the video, man. It's CrypticTMG. Like and subscribe. Peace.